astray. Oh no. Oh, say, say, say.
I love this.
Sipping on straight glory. Let the vibe slide over me. This beat is a chemical. Beat is a chemical. When I leave, don't say my seat. I'll be back when it's all complete.
Got a few people rolling in, so give it another minute or two. All right, I think most people are here, so I'm gonna start. How's everyone doing? I hope your week's going well. So some updates. So I don't know if I mentioned last class the homework that was due today. So if you did it for today, great, perfect, thank you. If you didn't know about it or I didn't mention it, you guys can have until Monday to do it. I want to make sure that you do it. It's once again, the homework is on a little bit more information on how those rumen digesters do, cows, you know, sheep, or organisms that are, you know, helping break down cellulose and other types of very hard to digest plant material. I would like you to know that. So please make sure you complete that. I also posted on Moodle a study guide. So the study guide, I took the concept questions, edited a little of them, but I also cut them down. So I removed a number of the different things that, you know, there's so much that we've covered already that can't possibly test you all in all of it. So I cut down those questions. So make sure you look over the study guide. In that way, I will, once again, I will have a, I will have a review session on Tuesday during my office hours from 5 to 7. So you can come ask questions. I'll make sure to record that, that session, and I'll post it on YouTube, like the other, lecture links. So you can review any questions that anyone has for that. In terms of the contents of the quiz will be, you know, similar to what you've seen before. We're going to have multiple choice questions. I'll have some fill in the blank type scenarios, a few, like, you know, paragraphs about information where you fill in the appropriate stuff. So obviously, once again, you know, when you take the quiz, be aware that I'm going to have to manually grade a bunch of it. There's also going to be a few more short answers. So those don't have a definitive length. There'll be like little mini essay questions that are, you know, a couple of sentences to, you know, a small paragraph, depending on the context of it. And so I think that's good, because I think a lot of this information does better in a comparative kind of manner. And so I'd rather, you know, you answer a short answer question and then me be able to give you some, you know, partial credit for your understanding, you know, just in case it's not completely right. So, so it'll be a little bit more on short answer, but again, I think that's better to give everyone a little chance to be able to respond. Any questions about the quiz or anything so far? No? Okay. So today, I gave you all a paper on, for the synthesis day, on the diving bell spider. So in terms of the synthesis days for today and going forward, what I like to do is give you a scientific paper, and have you read it and go over, you know, how scientists actually get the information that we do. I think, having an understanding of how we gather information can give greater context to the research that, or the information we're given, right? I at least personally, making it less of a black box in terms of how we understand the world around us helps me at least, kind of solidify those ideas. So I'm not going to be quizzing you on any of the specifics about, you know, diving bell metabolism or how scientists do these measurements. I just think it's interesting and important that we know that it's not just a black box. And so I have those questions that I listed on online. So in a little bit, I will send you into breakout rooms like we did before, and you know, I'll bounce around, try to answer your questions about what it is. But first, I wanted to give just a little bit more context about this world, you know, the world that we're dealing with, specifically in terms of breathing underwater, and as well as, you know, the emerging properties of, you know, surface tension and things like that. So, you know, in the In the beginning of this semester of this course, Persian was talking about all these chemical properties, how you know, the elemental properties, the electronegativity of these different compounds and molecules scale up and have very real ramifications for how organisms have to interact with their world. So the first thing I'd like to do is actually show a quick video on, it's not the diving bell spider, but it is on a another aquatic insect that utilizes bubbles and air tension, surface tension of water in order to breathe underwater. It also gives a little bit more context to, again, these chemical properties and how water's properties allow for things like this to occur. So I'm going to start with that.
We think we know what water feels like, how it behaves. But perception is a matter of scale. For very small animals, water feels different. It has different properties. It's almost gooey. And for some insects, this strange fact is key to their survival. Meet nature's scuba divers. These insects breathe underwater because they carry their air with them, in some cases for a lifetime. What makes this possible is a force almost too subtle for bigger animals like us to notice: surface tension. Here's how it works. Water molecules are drawn to each other. They're kind of sticky. And at the surface, that creates a film that can actually carry weight. That's surface tension. It also allows bubbles to form. This beetle traps a bubble with his outer wings. Then he hauls it under the surface while he hunts for food. See how the bubble is attached to his rump? That's where his breathing holes are. When he's used up the oxygen in the bubble, he lets it go and returns to the surface for a new one. These beetles have a different technique. They're born on land, but they enter the water as adults and they never go back. That's because part of their shells are covered in tiny bristles, which use surface tension to trap a layer of air known as a plastron. That coating of air gives this beetle a gold shimmer, almost like she's in a spacesuit. Surface tension keeps this whole menagerie alive. All these insects have found ways to carry air with them underwater. But it's fragile. Just a little bit of soap can disrupt surface tension, destroy its magical properties. When surface tension breaks, a whole world can drown. Just like these paper clips sinking to the bottom of the bowl. And even though we're bigger, we still rely on it. Surface tension allows raindrops to form, trees to carry water to their leaves, ice to float. We may not always notice surface tension, but we need it just as much as they do.
Cool. Yeah, so as that was saying, there are different techniques in order to trap air, right? In the first case, you had that beetle that was physically using its abdomen to hold air inside of it. Whereas that second beetle is more similar to what we're talking about with this underwater spider, right? It's one that is looking at hairs. Like if you see and look at this spider right here in this panel C, you can see that its legs are covered in these thin hairs, which help trap air and create, again, that layer that allows them to breathe. And so one thing that's really cool about these organisms is it's all emerging chemical properties, right? This is that extremely strong cohesive force, those hydrogen bonds that are forming in water, and it's making it so that oxygen is being trapped within this small space because of those bonds, because you are not breaking the connection between the water. And so this allows organisms, as long as they are small enough in order to hold on to water. And so one thing that that video didn't mention, you know, water is very gooey for insects. And that's why if you ever, you know, if you've ever had a pool or been to a pool in the summer and there are insects that have fallen into the water, that's the reason why that insect doesn't just fly out or crawl out of the water. It's extremely sticky. Think of it being attached to like a rubber band. You have those hydrogen bonds that are binding to you that are holding it in place. And so you wind up getting, you know, glued and stuck. If you ever try to pull an insect out, it's actually a little bit difficult, right? And they also form this little precipice around them. And so for this day, I wanted to talk about how scientists talk about metabolism. And so one thing we'd like to talk about is the fact that, you know, metabolism is a very difficult thing to physically see, right? It's almost impossible for us to gauge, you know, besides, you know, looking at someone and being like, oh, that person's tired. Maybe they're exerting themselves. There's not really a way that we can just simply notice how these metabolic processes in an organism are working, right? There's a lot of intricacies, as we discussed earlier in the past weeks. Animals are losing heat through metabolism. They are producing wastes as well as an excess of chemicals, which are all using energy in some way, in some pathway. Whether or not they're losing energy, they are using energy. And so scientists, it's very hard for them to simply go into an organism and pull out information, right? You can't just pull out a cell and figure out what its metabolism is. And so scientists have to figure out a lot of clever ways to inadvertently test how metabolism works. And so before we get into exactly how this paper does it, I wanted to show you another video about how we calculate metabolism for, say, humans and other large organisms, because these techniques are applicable also to our systems in this way. And so, for instance, this is a video talking about the only, at least as of 2018, I'm not sure, in the last 3 years, if they have increased their availability, but this is the only human-sized calorimeter for measuring stress. And so when we look at this instrument that they've built to test people, we'll realize that we do the same things with animals, just in a smaller confined space. But these ideas are applicable in the same way. So,
called a direct air calorimeter. It's the only one in the world. And what it does is it allows us to make really precise measurements of how much heat the body's losing. The way it works is we measure temperature entering a small chamber and then the temperature exiting. And we also measure the humidity entering the room and also exiting the room. So from those measurements, we can calculate how much heat the body is losing. We can also measure metabolic rate with what's called an indirect calorimetry. So it's kind of a metabolic mass. And from the difference between the metabolic heat production and the heat we lose via sweating, we can then calculate how much heat is being stored within the body. The reason why that's really important is because often measurements of core temperature are not always precisely reflecting how much heat is being stored in the body. And that allows us to answer some really unique questions and also get a better sense of why certain individuals respond differently to thermal stress. So what you might see during a heat wave is that over the course of an hour, we may not see much of a change in our body temperature. But what's actually happening is the body is progressively storing heat during that time. That's why we I think we often see some of those effects of a heat wave that tend to be within several days after the heat wave has actually hit. So it's usually 2 to 3 days afterwards we see kind of the most dangerous conditions.
And so when we're looking at this video and we're looking at this, what are we measuring here, right? So we have a number of different things. Look how complicated this setup is because of all of the ways that our body loses and expresses that metabolism, right? So in here right now, we have the most basic setup, which is this calorimeter here, in which it's actually measuring as this person breathes. It measures the amount of oxygen as well as CO2 that's being produced. And so it can actually measure, you know, how much respiration you're undergoing. And so that's, you know, part of how we can measure metabolism, right? So in a simple setup with an organism that is on land, and so obviously this gets much more complicated in water, which is why these diving bell spiders are a little bit of a challenge. But you're losing metabolism through, you know, the respiration, right? But there are a lot of other ways in which your body is losing that that heat and or energy and using it. And so in this setup, what they're also doing is, this is a completely controlled temperature room. Humidity, temperature, oxygen in and out. And so what they're measuring is, as this person works out, or in this case, you know, they could do it for someone sitting there at a basal rate, right? Or they could be doing it now as this person works out, is they're measuring the amount of heat that's lost. So the amount of temperature that the body is rising. Because obviously, as you work out more, as you undergo those processes, you're going to be sweating. And that's going to be in response to that heat your body's innately losing. And so they have to measure your temperature. As that person said, they're also going to be measuring the humidity of the room. And why is that? Because on land, especially for, you know, humans, the humidity might not be as important for, say, an animal that doesn't perspire. But humans are, you know, producing water in order to maintain homeostasis, right? As this person's body heats up, they're losing energy, but they're also making it so that their enzymes, that each of their proteins are going to be in a, their cells are going to be in a higher temperature environment, which may negatively affect their overall metabolism and ability to undergo processes. You know, think about it in terms of, you know, those activation energies we were talking about before. You know, if you heat up, you're actually giving more energy to your cells, which may make reverse reactions easier. It may start denaturing proteins and make those enzymes worse at their job. And so there are a lot of different possible outcomes to this. And so as this person's working out, that homeostasis is kicking in, that person's starting to sweat, and then that water, if not, it's going to evaporate, right? And so that's actually going to increase the humidity in the room. And so you can get a gauge on each of these types of metabolism, or on total metabolism, based on each of these factors. But this is the only, you know, box in the world right now that's set up to fully try to pull in as many of these ideas as possible, all of these different ways that we're losing heat, to get as accurate of a representation of metabolism. If we're looking at animals, this is there's no words, I believe, but this is just a video. Just a box looking at how we measure this in animals. And so in here we have this box that's been set up in order to look at this metabolic processes in rats. If you look at this, this is actually a pretty simple setup. This is something that a student made in their own lab space. You have some Arduinos, which we use to code stuff. We have some more simple computer chips in order to direct the flow. Oh, yes. Great point, Professor Aiken. Yes, exactly. We're trying to preserve ideal conditions to external changes. And so we need to change how the environment's changing in response to us to figure out what's going on the inside. And so in this setup, we have these different controller chips. We then have a CO2 reader as well as an O2 reader in order to get those two different aspects from this organism. Device description. Let's go over here. Where's the mouse? And so here's a fluffy little fake mouse. And so we have air pump being controlled. We have a computer that is going to be taking in information and then And so this is essentially a mini version of what they were doing for the people, except they're not, you know, obviously doing as much indication of like core body temperature, right? So this information would be representative of, you know, what the metabolism is for that organism, probably more likely, more accurate for an organism that's at rest, one that's not necessarily undergoing some type of stress. I'm actually not sure if rats can sweat or what their method of removing excess heat from their body is. But, you know, there could be some adaptations to make that a little bit better. You know, for instance, I know dogs, you know, they don't sweat, but they pant, and their panting releases similar amounts of humidity and removes air. Okay. So, All right, so let's go back here. Cool. So, does anyone want to explain or talk about how, I guess the first thing we should do is I should send you into the breakout rooms so we can discuss this paper and start working on those questions a little bit. And then we will reconvene and go over, you know, the methodology to which these scientists, these scientists have broken down measuring this bubble, you know, underwater in a more difficult situation. All right, so let's see. I'm going to give you all, like, you know, 8 to 10 minutes. I'm going to send you into breakout rooms. Let's see. And I'll be bouncing around between them.
I think, you want me to bounce around rooms or you want me to hang out in one room?
It's up to you. Yeah. I figured we'd just do what we normally did. Do you want to start at the top or the bottom?
Yeah. So I don't see, let me see here if I'm allowed to, I'm assigned to one room and I can't move around rooms.
Okay.
I think I already am normally, but if you have an option there to make me a co-host or something, well, let me see if there's a way I can claim host. More. All right, don't worry about it. Don't waste time with me. I'll see if I can figure it out.
I had a student who was also not in a room. Participants. Colin. I can withdraw your co-host permission.
Don't worry about it. Don't worry about me. Deal with a student.
Okay. All right. Yeah. No worries. Yeah. Enjoy. You're not teaching anymore. All right. Let's see. I'm gonna bounce. Howdy. How's everyone doing in here?
Hello.
Howdy. So, let's see. So were we able to go over some of these questions? Or do we have any questions about the methodology of this paper and things like that?
Not yet. I'm still kind of working my way through it, trying to understand it.
Okay. All right. Cool. All right. Well, I'll be bouncing around. Send me a message if anyone's wondering. How do I switch?
I think I got kicked out of the meeting. I went back in the wrong, I think I'm in the wrong breakout room.
Oh, it's okay. Let's see.
Prof Diaz, I figured out how to bounce around, so I'm gonna start bouncing. I'll keep bouncing around.
Oh, okay. Thank you. How do I send you to another breakout room? Nope, not in the, I don't want to put you in the waiting room. Oh, okay. It's already in there.
They were using ATP, and so that kind of changes the rate.
Howdy. So. How's everyone doing?
Hi. Good. We were just going through the questions.
Okay. Did we have any questions about any of it so far? Or?
I don't think so. I don't have any specific questions right now, but...
All right. All right. Well, I'm going to keep bouncing around then, and I'll see you all in a little bit.
Thank you. Thank you.
We need the cart captioner in room one.
Oh, I didn't even think about that. You're right.
No, no worries. I got it. Okay. How do we do that?
Cart captioner.
I'm currently in room five. You got it?
Okay. Yes. Yes. I didn't even think about that. Sorry. Oh, wait. No, I was just here.
A breakout. The Wi-Fi keeps kicking me out of the meeting. Keeps failing on me.
Yeah. Here we go. Go. Let's send you here.
All right. Just thank you.
Yes. Howdy. How's everyone doing in here?
Good.
Good. Did we have any questions on anything so far, or how do we think we're doing?
I think we're just reading at this point, but. We might have questions later, but for now, we're just reading.
Okay. All right.
Okay. Four. I'm going top down. Just go.
Are you talking about just like their little net that they have to catch their air bubble?
Yeah, yeah.
Hi, everyone. How are you all doing?
Hi, we're good. I think we're on four now.
Okay.
How is the pressure gel around the body different from that of the bubble? What is the difference in size matter? Well, I would say with the difference in size, I mean, we've been talking about how surface area versus volume affects things, and that I feel like, hold on, let me see how to phrase this. If we have a small spider, they're going to be able to get more surface area. Or the gill around their body. But I'm not quite sure how the pressure gill around the body differs from that of the air bubble. Do you guys have any input on that?
I'm not entirely sure about like the specifics of like the pressure gel, but I'm trying to find figure five that might help us. I guess one thing I think of that might be related is just this idea that we kind of covered about how if you have like a smaller organism, they lose heat easier since they have like a larger surface area on the outside, but a smaller volume on the inside. And how like for like a larger organism, like the struggle is less about heat loss since you have a larger volume on the inside and a smaller like relative surface area on the outside, and how your issue is more about like transporting materials and stuff like that. And I wonder if this idea of like smaller organisms having like the concern of heat loss has anything to do with the pressure gel, or if it's completely unrelated.
So to kind of work through this, part of it is you're right along the lines of talking about like volume to surface. But in this case, we're talking about volume to surface ratio, but for the bubble. So in this case, you know, the aqua lung, the bubble that's being created by the spider, is a much bigger concentration of oxygen, which allows it to be stabilized for a longer period of time. Whereas that small layer that's around their body is going to be depleted much faster, especially because the smaller, it essentially means that they have a smaller amount of oxygen that they can utilize, right? So as they're breathing and going through their metabolic processes, that bubble is going to have to be replaced much more often.
So I think so, pretty much like it's a diver with an oxygen tank, and you know, bigger oxygen tank means you're down longer and you're
exactly. Well, yeah. It's like having the scuba pack on you versus like being in a submarine, right? That submarine's going to have a larger amount of oxygen and sustain you for longer. Cool. All right. Sweet.
Okay. Then
question five.
And what you do about spiders, why might digestion under the water be difficult for the spider? What type of behavior do you think it can do to fix this? Well, spiders need to, you know, and
how's everything going in here?
Going well.
Going well. Do we have any questions so far about anything?
No, I think we're good at the moment.
All right. Okay. Cool. See you all in a few minutes. All right, one last one.
Okay. I've been through all of them. There weren't any questions.
Okay. All right. I was about to broadcast that. Oh, I guess I could just close all the rooms, but I'll say closing them in a minute.
Yeah.
Maybe I gave him too many questions. There's just too many things to ask. All right.
You'll, I mean, you can always let them work on the rest of them later.
Oh, it says all breakout rooms immediately. 60 seconds to return. Interesting. Okay. Sweet. Never seen that.
Oh, no. Don't leave.
All right, welcome back, everyone. I hope your discussions are good. So just to go over some of these questions, as a quick note, I just wanted to show you a quick thing about these spiders. So we have this idea, you know, of sexual dimorphism in biology, the idea that certain traits are expressed differently. Especially physical traits in one organism, in one sex or gender compared to the other. And so for reference, when you talk about like spiders that are in webs, this is a black widow, for instance, over here. This is the female black widow and this is the male black widow. A lot of organisms, especially spiders, the male is significantly smaller than the female because it has to run around and hide and try to find females, whereas the female is usually big, wants to produce as many eggs as possible, and is generally larger to protect herself. These underwater spider, those are the exact opposite. So the males are actually the larger ones, and it's interesting because scientists were wondering why this opposite relationship. And they believe it's because these spiders have to swim underwater. So being, you know, bigger makes it easier to fight that surface tension. But as a quick note, can someone tell me the answer to the first question, how scientists measured the metabolism of these spiders? There are two different methods. Or there are two methods they combined in order to tell.
Didn't they measure the release of carbon dioxide and the difference in pressure, partial pressure of oxygen across the diving bells when the spiders were and weren't there to effectively look at oxygen consumption, carbon dioxide release?
Exactly. Exactly. So that would be figure number 6 from the paper. Exactly what they did, right? They couldn't. It was difficult underwater for them to actually measure all of those respiratory things, right? And so what they did was they looked at the volume of the air bubble over time without a spider. So how much oxygen is naturally being lost by the environment because, you know, it is underwater. There is this high concentration of oxygen, right? And so it's going to naturally diffuse into the less oxygenated water around it. And so they tried to track how much that occurs. And what they saw was at a very small volume at this tiny area, it actually didn't lose too much volume over time innately. So this would be the dashed line of an empty bell. They then looked at the volume over time with a spider in it and tried to measure this loss and how much additional volume was lost. So one thing that they mentioned in this paper was the idea that any time that a spider moved within the bubble, they actually threw out that data point. So why do you think it's important that they removed, or why did they choose to remove those data points when testing this? Anyone have any ideas?
I was thinking of like how their lungs work when they have to move at all, or like when they run, they pretty much have asthma, as you were mentioning yesterday. So their lungs like kind of have to
deal with that change, and so that would affect the rate of carbon dioxide that they'd measure.
Yeah, so that's definitely true. It's less to do specifically with the way that their lungs work. But as you just said, right, when the spider is moving, what's going to happen to its metabolism? It's going to, right, it's going to increase. And so that's going to be very different in terms of its oxygen use than it will be when this organism is just freely, you know, sitting in there, not exerting itself, right? There's, when we looked at those metabolism curves for different organisms, you know, a certain amount of it was thermoregulation, a certain amount of it was innate metabolism, but some of it was, you know, active energy, right? How this organism is moving around. So great, thank you. That's totally correct. Let's see. And then, so when we're discussing these different, you know, types of bubbles, this question about sustainability of those bubbles. So how is the pressure gill around the body different from the bubble? So when looking at figure five, yes, exactly. Figure five. So how does the bubble shape of the bubble work versus that of the around its body? Why would there be a different behavior, say, for this bubble that it's created versus the smaller bubble on its body, the scuba pack versus, as I was describing to one group, as like the submarine that it's living in? Why would those behave differently? Any ideas?
Well, the bubble, like the bubble that it has around its body, has a higher surface tension, so it's easier for more oxygen to diffuse out of it, and so its oxygen content goes down further. Whereas the diving bell has a cocoon of sorts around it, so that makes it more contained.
Actually, so that's actually a very good point. I didn't think about the fact that the oxygen is actually being held in place by that cocoon. You're right, that diving bell, it's causing the oxygen to not diffuse out because it's being blocked on one side. That's a really good point. So what I was getting at in that question is pretty much what you said, which was the idea of surface to volume ratio. But something I didn't think about that you just mentioned that's actually true is, you know, in the diving bell surrounding the spider, it is, you know, a smaller volume. It's just this little area that's surrounding it. So it's going to readily lose oxygen more often, but that's going to be a larger amount of, say, the volume being exposed. That surface area is larger. Whereas when you have this bell here, you're right. So this area is going to be unable to diffuse because it's being held together by silk. And so it's only going to be this bottom half that is going to be as openly losing oxygen. But because this bubble, and since the spider's in this bubble, it actually helps sustain it. So one thing that's cool that happens in this bubble that doesn't really happen in the spider's abdomen bubble because it's moving around so much, is that as this spider is sitting in this bubble, it is producing carbon dioxide and it's using a small amount of oxygen. And so a really cool thing about the diving bell is that the increase in carbon dioxide from the spider respiring actually causes the amount of carbon dioxide in this bubble to be much higher than the surrounding water. So carbon dioxide will actually naturally diffuse out into the water, which keeps it a little bit more fresh. So you actually have carbon dioxide going into the water and then oxygen diffusing back against the carbon dioxide back into this bubble as the spider is breathing. So when the spider is sitting in here, it can actually sustain the oxygen content of that water just by passive diffusion, as long as it's not being very active. And so let's see, any last minute questions I want to ask? And then I guess one last question, just on this figure 13, when it's looking at when it's looking at the spider mass versus oxygen consumption, does this trend make sense based on what we've learned so far about metabolism and how it scales up in organisms?
My first instinct was to say no, because originally we had learned that smaller animals require a higher metabolic rate in order to maintain their body temperature. So the fact that larger spiders require more oxygen seems contradictory.
Okay. So that's that's completely true, right? You're right that these smaller organisms are going to lose things to the environment. So the trick with this figure compared to what we learned, though, is that this is not being scaled based on the size of the spider. So if you were to say, look at a mouse versus an elephant, you know, the elephant is going to use more energy than the mouse simply because it's bigger and has more metabolic processes. Proportionally to its mass, though, it's going to be lower. And so this figure shows that common trend, which obviously as the spider gets bigger, it will need more oxygen and have a higher metabolism. But you're completely correct. If we were to say, take these values and start to normalize them, you know, divide this point by 70, divide this point by 10, the trend that you're talking about will be shown. It will start to decrease proportionally to the amount of mass that the spider has in itself. All right. Yes, exactly. As Professor Aiken said, less energy per gram of body mass. I will post this, you know, short presentation with just links to those videos if you'd like to look at them. But that's all I have for you today. Make sure that you look over the study guide. Make sure you look over the study guide and come with questions. On Monday, we will be starting the next unit. So look on Moodle, everything should be up there. But obviously, if you have any questions over the weekend, you can email me, but we'll go and talk about stuff on Tuesday in terms of the review sessions.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye, guys. Have a good weekend.
Sorry. I just had a question. Do you want us to submit our answers now for this, or should we just look at your answer key later and study? For the synthesis day. Worksheet.
Yeah, use the key and study.
Okay, so you don't want us to submit anything? Okay.
Yeah, no, you're not going to hand in.
All right, just wanted to check if anything changed. All right.
Yeah.
Thanks.
No worries. Anyone have Jonathan, Annie? You got any questions, concerns?
No, sorry, I was just listening.
Oh, no worries. Just checking.
All right. Thanks so much. Take care.
You're welcome. Take care.
Thank you.
Bye. All right.